From the studios of Farm Journal Broadcast, this is AgDay.
Coming up today on AgDay,
the tears of joy in her eyes were just incredible.
An exhibitor at this year's San Antonio Stock Show captures hearts and breaks records.
You know, we want to do our part to be sustainable.
A farmer is still finding a way to still be sustainable amid tough weather conditions as another powerful winter weather system makes its way across the country. Good morning, I'm Betsy Gibbon. Clinton is on assignment. A major cross-country winter storm is moving across the plains and into the Midwest right now. Snow and gusty winds leaving their mark on South Dakota. Take a look at these scenes, courtesy of Safety Travel USA. A winter storm warning in the Black Hills area where many roads are closed or impassable, according to the National Weather Service. 5 inches of snow were recorded in downtown Rapid City and 7 inches in Spearfish and Belle Fourche. Meteorologist Cindy Clausen is tracking this storm.
Yeah, and you'll be seeing some more snow by the end of the week in the Dakotas, but our focus today is really going to be in the northeastern United States. This is the past 24 hours, and you can see this is just one model, but the estimate of snow in many cases, 2 to 4 inches, perhaps more in spots, up to 7 o'clock Wednesday morning. But when you add the next 24 hours, that whole system, boy, does that spread into the northeast. And this is the GFS model. You can see how it really favors a lot of snow, potentially over a foot in the western part of New York. But you can see a lot of the eastern Corn Belt and on into the northeast, including New England, seeing a fair amount of snow. We'll take a look at your national forecast coming up in just a few minutes. Betsy.
Stocks slipping again on Tuesday, a day after the market's biggest drop in more than 2 years. The steep sell-off erasing all of the Dow's gains so far for the year. The drop blamed on concerns about the coronavirus threatening global economic growth. China on Tuesday reporting 508 new cases of coronavirus infections. Mainland China is reporting more than 80,000 confirmed cases and 27,000 recovered cases since the outbreak started in December. Meanwhile, China has made it illegal to trade or eat wild animals. The World Health Organization saying 70% of global disease-causing bacterium discovered in the past 50 years came from animals.
The immediate risk to the general American public remains low. But as we have warned, that has the potential to change quickly.
President Trump is trying to minimize fears about the coronavirus, saying the situation is, quote, very well under control in our country, end quote. At the same time, his administration has asked Congress for an additional $2.5 billion for preparations in case of a widespread outbreak. The requested money would go towards developing a vaccine and stockpiling protective gear, among other efforts. The president addressing the issue at a news conference in New Delhi following meetings with India's prime minister.
We lost almost 1,000 points yesterday on the market, and that's something, you know, things like that happen where, and you have it in your business all the time. Had nothing to do with you. It's an outside source that nobody would have ever predicted. If you go back 6 months or 3 months ago, nobody would have ever predicted. But let's see, I think it's going to be under control. And I think I can speak for our country. For our country is under control.
Democratic House Speaker Nancy Pelosi is criticizing the White House's budget request, saying the plan was long overdue and completely inadequate. She indicated the House will propose its own funding package. The U.S. Trade Representative releasing information about progress being made on the Phase 1 trade agreement with China. It's pointing to several actions since the agreement went into force on February 14th, including the signing of a protocol that allows for China to import U.S. fresh chipping potatoes, which are potatoes used to make chips and French fries, lifting of the ban on imports of U.S. poultry, and lifting restrictions on imports of U.S. pet food containing ruminant material. U.S. Trade Representative Robert Lighthizer saying the president signed the Phase 1 agreement a little more than a month ago, and we are already seeing positive results. But still, the market hasn't seen those big China ag buys, and that has many farmers and traders concerned. President Trump is signaling the possibility of another round of trade aid for farmers, tweeting Friday, if farmers need additional aid until the trade deals fully kick in, that aid will be provided by the federal government. Ag Secretary Sonny Perdue's office responding to AgDay's request for a statement, saying, quote, the president's tweet today shows that he stands prepared to do another round of MFP if necessary, I hope we can show that a third round is not needed for 2020. We still believe farmers want trade rather than aid," end quote. Perdue saying, while we haven't seen the market rise as officials were hoping after the agreement, he believes it will. Another of those trade agreements of concern, the U.S.-Mexico-Canada agreement. It has been approved by both Mexico and the U.S., but still needs approval in Canada. But speaking at USDA's Ag Outlook Forum, Canada's Minister of Agriculture said the country will ratify the agreement soon.
We are going through our normal legislative process, but I can tell you that it's on the fast track. I don't see any, you know, significant challenges, and we should be able to proceed soon with that. So I just want to reassure everyone that we're really committed to have it ratified as soon as we can.
Former Ag Secretary Tom Vilsack is adding a new job to his list of responsibilities, monitoring a major drug company. Perdue Pharma, the maker of OxyContin, appointing Vilsack as its monitor. His job is to make sure the company does not improperly promote the sale of its drug products. Perdue Pharma filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy in November after a slew of lawsuits were filed over one of the company's painkillers. Vilsack, now the head of the U.S. Dairy Export Council, the council releasing a statement to AgDay saying that Vilsack intends to continue working for USDEC.
The American Soybean Association Conservation Legacy Awards are brought to you by the United Soybean Board. As demand for sustainability rises, meeting those demands remains a journey of continuous improvement. Which sustainable practices do you do now? Which ones could you adopt to improve your sustainable footprint?
Farmers in the Carolinas have been dealing with extreme weather challenges throughout the last couple of years. One farmer is finding ways to still use conservation practices despite those tough conditions. AgDay's Clinton Griffiths introduces us to another 2020 Conservation Legacy Award winner.
When life gives Monroe, North Carolina farmer Frank Howie a curveball, he finds another path.
We started off extremely wet, like the Midwest, had a late planting spring. And then it turned off really hot and dry.
Challenging weather is nothing new for the corn, wheat, soybeans, timber, and cattle farmer.
It seems to me the weather is more and more extreme.
From hurricanes to mid-season droughts, he and his wife Allison have found ways to succeed.
And we plant our corn in 15-inch rows, which is not normal.
Howie, a 15-inch row pioneer, has converted both corn and soybeans to that system.
The narrow rows, we get a quicker canopy in the spring before it gets real hot and dry. That helps us with weed control and moisture retention.
It also works well with no-till, which he's been doing since 1984.
The residue from the previous crop, if we don't disturb the soil, it helps as a barrier to break up the rainfall droplets to prevent erosion, but it also helps us store moisture in our shallow soils.
A practice that one day may have dividends beyond the soil and moisture payoffs.
We're going to be able to keep more carbon, and hopefully we're going to be able to supplement our income with the sale of carbon credits.
He's also installed grass waterways and taken on stream restoration projects.
Done tree plantings to improve the habitat for the wildlife, and also it slows the water down.
Adding rocks.
We actually take the rocks that are a nuisance in our field and we'll make a rock dam with them to slow the water down.
And a more pronounced curve to help slow the flow and filter out any sediment.
You know, we want to do our part to be sustainable and to look after the people downstream of us, and we hope the people upstream of us are doing a good job.
They've allowed several solar projects on the farm and plant roughly 150,000 trees a year on marginal lands.
Loblolly pines or longleaf pine are what we normally plant, and they provide habitat and cover for wildlife, and it's a crop.
As the city pushes out, Howie has utilized the demand to his advantage today and for tomorrow.
But we've also looked at it as opportunity to do a retail deal with the farm.
A project he's planning to leave to the next generation.
We've done a permanent conservation easement on our home farm, and it'll never be developed. It'll always be farmland.
It's a legacy, ready to weather any storm.
You know, we're in it for the long term and for the next generation, and we want to be good stewards of the land and leave it better than we found it.
Still ahead, how will livestock producers turn a profit this year despite current cattle levels? We have more in today's analysis. And later, the story behind this grand champion barrow and the girl who guided it in the ring.
The American Soybean Association Conservation Legacy Awards are brought to you by BASF. The No Compromise, No Excuses Soybean Solution, Revitech Fungicide.
Has struck a deal with Impossible Foods to sell plant-based options at its theme parks, resorts, and cruise ships. The partnership makes Impossible the preferred plant-based burger of Walt Disney World Resort, Disneyland Resort, and Disney Cruise Line. Disney choosing Impossible Foods over rivals such as Beyond Meat. Concerns about the coronavirus and the lack of big ag buys from China are continuing to weigh on the markets. Here's an update from the CME.
Dollar a little bit cheaper. Good news, right? We've got beans eking their way a little higher. And then lastly, look, we set a 9-month low yesterday in May beans. So maybe that'll be carving in something that we can start to build off going forward. So keep that in mind. That'll be a target for the technicians. And again, when the world around you is acting crazy and you can't make sense of this fundamental news, and sometimes the news is just fun, that's going to be something that's going to be hard to trade off of, and you're going to have to rely back on those technical levels. So technically speaking, we set a new 9-month low in May beans yesterday. Keep an eye on that because that could be a trigger point in the short term.
The latest cattle on feed report shows the industry has plenty of cattle on hand to deal with as carcass weights climb. How should producers digest the news? Tyne Morgan has more with this livestock analysis from our Kansas City studio.
Here now with Scott Brown, economist at the University of Missouri. Scott, when we look at cattle prices, when we look at demand versus supply, really what matters more right now?
Well, I will always say right now we're in a situation where supplies are growing. We've got more cattle in feed yards than we had a year ago. Maybe one of the worrisome things is weights have been higher. I think we were 12 pounds higher dressed weight here in the last week or so in terms of cattle weights. So although we talk about fewer cattle and calves when we start the year, we've still got current fed cattle supplies to deal with, and we seem to be adding to weights. Relative to last year, I remind us last year was a very tough winter, and I think that really hurt on weights, but supplies are growing.
So is that the biggest issue for on the cow-calf side? I mean, hearing from a lot of those producers that are struggling, worried about turning a profit again in 2020, is that the biggest obstacle for those producers?
So I think it is. I think you got to find a situation for feed yards to be more excited about placing more cattle, and right now with lots that are, you know, near record levels, there's a lot less incentive to bid hard. It reminds me of in 2014 when we had really high feeder cattle prices. It was feed yards who were working really hard to get those calves. They don't have to work nearly as hard today for those calves. For cow-calf producers, I always say, what am I going to do to focus on making sure my calves are seen as higher quality, whether that's feeding better, better health, better grading when they're ultimately finished? Those are the things that are going to distinguish these markets.
For demand on that side of beef, do we need both Japan and China this year, or do you think China could stand alone if we do not see China, or Japan could stand alone if we don't see China come to the plate significantly?
I keep saying I think Japan's could potentially be really big for what happens in terms of beef markets this year. Just with the lowering of the tariff and the issues that we see in Australia, I expect us to see some growth there. So I think it could help carry. You put China on top of that, and it's just kind of that cherry on top. Now I remind us, let's not forget about domestic demand. We need strong domestic demand. I think we've seen it in beef. I think we've seen it in the higher quality side of beef. You know, I always say when somebody goes out for a really good meal, what do they get? They get steak. And so the beef industry's done really good at meeting that consumer expectation.
All right, Scott, thank you. We appreciate it. Let's take a quick break, and then we'll have a check of weather right here on AgDay.
Join Andrew McCrae for Farming the Countryside, a farmer-focused podcast all about production agriculture. Brought to you by Pivot Bio Proven, the nitrogen-producing microbes that stay put, weather or not. Visit pivotbio.com.
We're joined now with meteorologist Cindy Clausen. Cindy, it looks like we'll have snow, and more snow.
Yeah, especially if you are in the northeastern part of the U.S. because this has just been a large storm, a very complicated and just a very messy storm. So let's see what it's going to be bringing us today. the focus this morning, especially as you get into parts of the eastern Corn Belt. But that low is going to be moving off to the northeast, and watch that snow spread into eastern parts of the Great Lakes. We're still seeing that cold air wrap around the backside, and so we'll see some lake effect snow in the area as well. Notice the western half of the country fairly quiet, though we do see some snow, especially in those higher elevations out in the west. Heading into the overnight hours we go, and we see that low tracking up to the northeast. That snow, especially with the low and on the back side of that low, the trailing cold front now moving offshore, so we'll still see a little bit of rain trailing down into Florida, but some of that wetter weather moving out of the southeast. But the low continues to bring that snow up into the northeastern United States, and we will have some spotty wet weather in parts of the plain states. Now let's take a look at the precipitation. It's been a fair amount, especially in northern Florida, but that cold front's been moving offshore. So mostly it's been with the low, and you could see a fair amount of liquid associated with that snow into the northeast. So we're going to see that piling up there. And as we mentioned, here are the snowfall estimates. Now this is a different model that we're showing you, but you can see the track is very similar, even if the amounts might be slightly different in a few spots. But we're still looking at a lot of snow in the eastern Great Lakes and on up into the northeast, and some of those higher elevations out in the west. Temperature wise, we're seeing cool but not super cold temperatures in the upper Midwest. We're cooled down into a lot of the plains as well, with those highs in the 40s. Heading into the overnight hours, we're going to see those low temperatures dipping down into the single digits for the upper Midwest. We're going to see a bit of a warm up though as you get into the northern plains, but it's still going to be pretty chilly over towards Minnesota, Wisconsin, even Chicago, the Great Lakes area. We start to see things warming up though in especially a lot of the plain states. Let's take a quick look at that jet stream. There's that trough that is continuing to affect the eastern part of the country, and while it kind of takes a move further to the north, we're still seeing that very cold air in the northeast, and you see a nice ridge in the west. That'll bring you some warmer temperatures there. Heading into the weekend, we're still dealing with that trough in the northeast, and we'll start to see another one developing out in the west that will affect us as we get into the early part of next week. That's a look at your national forecast. Now let's check on the weather where you live. Stanfield, Oregon, mostly sunny today with a high temperature of 58 degrees. Heading on over to Spur, Texas, abundant sunshine for you with a high of 50 degrees. And Hudson, Michigan, breezy with snow likely, a high of 32.
Still ahead, while the world is focused on the coronavirus, there are new cases of African swine fever. Plus the story behind this winning moment that's going viral next. More wild boars have tested positive for African swine fever. According to a South Korean news agency, to date, 250 wild boars have been found with the virus near the border with North Korea. South Korea is the fourth biggest consumer of pork and has already buried more than 153,000 pigs since mid-September. A great story to share with you. One of the exhibitors at the San Antonio Stock Show broke records, barriers, and captured hearts in the show ring. You see Samantha Nicole Eiselt wearing the pink bow in this video. She showed what turned out to be the grand champion market barrow at the San Antonio Stock Show and Rodeo. The 17-year-old has Down syndrome. She usually has a helper in the ring when she shows, but didn't in San Antonio, doing it all on her own. Judges say Samantha's barrow was unique and one of the best they've seen. Farm Journal's Pork interviewed the judges.
He's been to a lot of shows, and he just said the atmosphere was just electrifying. One of my favorite comments that he said was, it was like time stood still when they shook her hand. And he said it was a moment that he will never personally forget, because her smile and the tears of joy in her eyes were just incredible.
Shike says she sold the pig for the record-breaking price at the show of $157,000 and received a $10,000 scholarship. It's a debate that's raged on for years now. Is it Jif or Gif? Now the famous peanut butter spread is getting in on the debate next. Your Jif will soon also be a Gif. Get this, the Jif, the popular peanut butter brand, is releasing a jar featuring the J replaced with a G. It's a partnership with Giphy, the popular GIF search engine. You know, GIF, as in those animated looping images you see online. The makers of Jif even putting the definition of GIF on the jar. By the way, it also says the word should be pronounced with a hard G, not a soft one. But the creator of the GIF has said it should be a soft G. Either way, the debate rages on, and the limited edition jars will sell on Amazon for $10. Man, that's a mouthful. Well, that's all the time we have this morning. We're glad you tuned in. For all of us here at AgDay, I'm Betsy Gibbon. Have a great day.